It is a Tuesday morning broadcast. It's JM in the AM, and we are in Tel Aviv tonight as part of the incredible Deer Shoe World Siyumim. That's right, Deer Shoe World Siyumim, which have included stops in so many different areas of the world, which we'll talk about. Tonight is the Deer Shoe Daf Hayomi Bahalacha World Siyum here in what at one time was called Yad Eliyahu, at one time was called the Nokia Center, and now is referred to as the Menorah Mivtachim Arena here in Tel Aviv, Israel. Plenty of details about what's going on. We're also going to be hearing from some of the top Torah personalities when it comes to words of inspiration, many of whom have already participated in some of the Deer Shoe World Siyumim, some of whom will be here tonight in Tel Aviv. There's a lot to do as we get set to celebrate here with Deer Shoe. It's the Daf Yomi Bahalacha. Many of our listeners have taken to this program already since we started discussing it, essentially studying Mishnah Berurah, Halacha, at the rate of one page per day. And now the first cycle, the very first cycle of the Daf Hayomi program for Halacha, the Daf Hayomi program for Jewish law, is coming to its conclusion tonight in Tel Aviv. We'll play some of the Deer Shoe selections, including some that were created very recently by Rav David Hofstetter and Moshe Laufer and the different musical people who are involved in their musical projects, and plenty more coming up on a Tuesday live from Tel Aviv. This is JM in the AM.
Tiri da da moi do 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 hi do da 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 Tiri da da moi do 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 hi do Tiri da 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 do Tiri da 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 Dirshu Hashem ve'yuzoi Bakshu ponov tomi Yisallelu, yisallelu Beshem kodshoi Yismach lev mevakshei Hashem Dirshu Hashem ve'yuzoi Bakshu ponov tomi Sallelu, sallelu, beshem kodshoi, yismach lev mevakshei Hashem. Oy dirshu Hashem beyuzoi, bakshu vovonov tomid. Sallelu, sallelu, beshem kodshoi, yismach lev mevakshei Hashem. Dirshu Hashem ve'yuzoi, bakshu vovonov tomid. Yisallelu, yisallelu, beshem kodshoi, yismach lev mevakshei Hashem. Hashem ve'yuzoi bakshu ponov tomid. Dirshu Hashem ve'yuzoi bakshu ponov tomid.
Hashem ve'yuzoi, bakshu ponov tomid.
Shem kotshoy yismach lev mevak sheyashe oy di yirshu Hashem beyuzoy vak shufo vavon avtomi yisallelu yisallelu beshem kotshoy yismach lev mevak sheyashe Shu Hashem beyuzoy, baba vakshu fo vavono v'tomim. Yisallelu, yisallelu, v'shem kodshoy, yismach lev mevakshei Hashem. Tiriradam, oiradadadohidom. Tiri da 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 da, tiri da da, oh, tiri da 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 da, tiri da 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 da, tiri da 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 da. Ay, 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 dirshu Hashem ve'yozoy, bahakshu fo'ono v'tomim, yisallelu, yisallelu, b'shem kodshoy, yismach lev mevakshei Hashem, dirshu Hashem ve'yozoy.
JM and the AM, we're live in Tel Aviv. Right behind me is a 10, 11, 12,000 seat arena, which will be filled later on tonight for the big Dirshu World Siyum. In North America, in the New York area, the big Shabbos convention, which has become an annual tradition already of Dirshu, took place on Parshas Vayakhel Pekudei back on March the 13th. That's where the whole celebration, the whole tour of this celebration began. Then on the 18th of March, which was a Wednesday in South Africa, there was a major celebration. That was the second stop on this Dirshu World Tour. One of the people who spoke was Diane Abrams, spoke at that event, others as well. That was back on the 18th of March. In England, and we're going to hear some of the excerpts of the presentations in the United Kingdom. In England, the big Shabbos convention took place Parshas Vayikra. That was last Shabbos, of course, starting on March the 20th, and that was a major event in England. France was at the end of this past weekend, a very inspiring, and you can imagine with everything that's been going on in France, you can imagine just how spiritual and how inspirational a Dirshu event was when Gedolei Torah gathered together to be part of it this past Sunday in a major arena in France, and we will again hear about that Siyum in France. And in addition, at 7:35 this morning, we're going to play the music that filled the arena in Paris. I'm assuming it was in Paris this past Sunday in France. Upcoming, after this big celebration in Israel, upcoming will be the South American celebration, which takes place later this week. That'll be down in South America. And, of course, tonight is the big event in Tel Aviv. They're actually going to be celebrating in both Tel Aviv and Yerushalayim. Those of you who are familiar with Binyanei HaOman, I'm sure there are plenty of our listeners who are. They'll be there. And of course, we'll be here at the Yad Eliyahu Stadium, which has its brand new name, the Menorah Miftachim Arena. I have been here for Israeli basketball in the past. I have never been here for a Siyum tonight. This place is going to be filled with incredible spirit, wonderful celebration, and a real Makom Torah. The list, for those of you who keep a roster of the great Torah giants in this world, the list that'll be here tonight in Tel Aviv is simply remarkable. The Dirshu World Siyum is on. We are here for the first of two shows. Tomorrow's show is actually going to be our broadcast from the actual event as it's taking place in back of us. When you hear the celebration tomorrow, it's not going to be a replay of what happened in France. It'll be the actual live presentation of what's going on here at Yad Eliyahu tonight. So that's our schedule for the week here at JM in the AM. Thanks so much for tuning in. Hope you're having a wonderful Tuesday morning so far back in the New York, New Jersey area. We're going to do this Dirshu selection, which is featuring Isaac Honig. It's one of their classics. It's called Summer. Here it is at JM in the AM.
Yo, 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 yo
Rabbi Yitzchak Safles tells me that Rav David Hofstetter is the composer of that selection sung by Isaac Honig here at JM the AM. I say good afternoon, or for those of you back in the U.S., I'll say good morning to Rabbi Yitzchak Safles, who is here at the Dirshu World Siyum in Tel Aviv. I see you would not miss this event, sir. Welcome to JM and the AM.
Thank you so much for having me.
A pleasure.
I apologize. My voice is a little bit...
Now, wait a second. Let me consult my map. You left your voice in France, the U.K., South Africa. Where'd you leave your voice? Where was it?
I'm not sure. Maybe back in America.
Actually. Oh, maybe then at the convention?
Yeah.
Why did the USA convention become such a popular event over the years?
You know, there are many conventions, and they're all fantastic.
Yeah, a lot of great organizations. Yeah.
And then the Dirshu convention had a specific goal and angle, and that was to represent people that are learning from all backgrounds.
Right.
And therefore, really, anyone that's there, you know, let me give you an example. One of the Rosh Yeshivas who was there for Shabbos commented, he said, I've been to many conventions, but I don't recall being at a convention when on Shabbos morning, if Shachris is 8 o'clock, at 6 o'clock the Beis Medrash is full.
Wow.
I think that gives a little bit of perspective.
So
I think that gives a little perspective.
So that's what they're concentrating on at the Dirshu convention.
They have Bechinis to take. Do you know at the UK convention, they had a testing site, and it was a packed room. I have a picture of a guy doing his Bechina on the wall.
They wouldn't let you be at the Siyum if you didn't pass. Is that what happened? No, they're not that strict. But
no.
Everyone's allowed to celebrate. But in all seriousness, they take the Torah study very seriously. We've pointed this out to our listeners many times, and you may have been a little surprised how this audience reacted. We had a lot of people who want
That's
to be
correct.
Part of a very serious
That's
Torah
correct.
Study.
When now, of course, a big thank you to Nachum Siegel and JM and the AM WFMU for hosting us this morning. I can't tell you how many comments since, and of course, you know, I apologize. I missed your great fundraiser this year.
Big thank you to our listeners. They were great.
My first year was 89. I was there with Mayor Fertig.
Wow.
When we walked down that long parking lot into a little building in a corner. Was the East. That was Orange.
East Orange, Georgia.
East Orange. I was there.
I didn't realize you were part of the fundraiser back
then. Yeah. Mayor Fertig brought me in.
Now I feel
our
guilty.
Mutual friend.
Now I feel guilty that you pledged so much last week.
So a very big thank you. And ever since... Your listeners have become familiar with Dirshu. The office has gotten a fantastic number of requests, and later we'll hear from Rabbi Aaron Gabioff,
right.
who runs Dirshu North America, about to join the programs. They want more information, and they heard about it on your airwaves.
Yeah,
so
the surprising
you.
Thing, again, this is not to – I'm not trying to joke around. I'm being serious. You say to yourself, do people who you know, have a casual approach – or want to add some type of casual approach to Torah study to their lives, whether it be Daf Yomi Bahalacha, etc., do they really want to go through a testing process? Do they really want to go through a really serious pursuit where people are, you know, are being held accountable for what they're supposed to be studying every single day? And surprisingly, the answer is yes. The answer is yes, that people want to be part of a formal program and make sure they really understand the material. And on top of that, another thing, we had this with Rabbi Fried. Remember when Rabbi Fried was in our studio?
Yes, Gavi Fried, Rabbi Gavi Fried.
I mean, I when he started describing how many people come to his shir and never miss and take it very seriously. And again, this is not to minimize or compare to any other shirim out there.
Right.
It's just to tell people that you think the more you add in terms of the responsibility of the student the more difficult it's going to be. It might be difficult, but people want to pursue it. They want to do it.
You know, Rabbi Friend came and joined the Dershow World team in the UK. And Rabbi Friend is always fantastic, always off the charts. And I believe that we're going to be playing
some of his clip soon, at some point.
Rabbi Friend said that over the last, I think he said over the last 50 years, there's been two Torah revolutions in North America.
Right.
He said the first one is no question. It's Art Scroll.
Right.
There's no question. Right. They made Torah accessible to the masses.
Correct.
He said the second one he sees from being present at the Shabbos and from what he's heard about is Dershu, where they then take the learning that someone has to a totally new level of accountability. He says, that's the secret, and that's the revolution that Dershu has done.
It's pretty amazing. Yitzchak Saflis is here. I thank him and everybody at Bottom Line Marketing Group, Pesach Tropper, Chaim Weiser, all the people who have been assisting you for God knows how long to get to this night. It's a big night for you because you've been building up for God knows how many months.
That's right.
And if you listen carefully, you hear some of the testing going on in the background.
Oh, yeah, it's a very exciting evening.
They're already starting to prepare the arena for this evening's event. I just want to break for a second and thank Josh Melman and everybody at Travel Cell, as we said yesterday from Stay Road. If not for Travel Cell, we'd have major problems here. They not only are keeping us connected to the U.S., but they are keeping us connected radio-wise to the U.S. as well, and I thank him. A big thank you to our friends at the Inbal Hotel and Alex Herman and his staff. We, again, are guests of the Inbal. They are our home base when we're in Israel. And, of course, Stan is in our studio. ZK and PC Guy are here. Danny Goldberg is taking care of our social media. And a big thank you to the Nachum Segal Network General Manager, Miriam L. Wallach, who not only is here but is coordinating everything for today's show, as she does every time we hit the road. All right, here we are. We're going to go to Rabbi Friend in a moment. These were words that he shared with everybody in the UK, right? This was in England. We mentioned and alluded earlier to the fact that in France, the godless, the greatness of the event, in addition to everything you'd expect from a Torah event, was that it was France, and obviously they needed a big boost. And that was one of the reasons you said that Rabbi Hofstetter insisted they go to France with the Dershow celebration.
Right.
It was to give a big boost to the community. If you had to, could you describe in a sentence or two the theme in England? Was there a specific spirit that was happening up there that accompanied the Dershow celebration?
There's a rush of emotion when you ask such a question, because I was there for Shabbos.
Oh, you went to England?
Yeah, I was there, and it was...
So you felt it.
It was so special. It was so special. But... You know what? I want to share a story. So just through a story, we could bring out what... Okay. In the American Shabbos, there's a tradition now at every Dershu Shabbos convention. By Mincha, for Shlishi, they sell the aliyah.
Just one aliyah?
They sell only one aliyah, because by Shachris, they give it to the...
Right.
There's so many Gedolim that are there.
And then Cohen and Levi are taken care of.
And Cohen and Levi are taken care of.
But Shlishi, they'll sell.
Shlishi, they sell.
Okay. The isolated aliyah gets put up for
one aliyah for sale. So that's a hot aliyah.
I can imagine.
But they don't sell it for money. They don't sell it for cash.
What do they sell it for?
For blot gemara.
Of how many pages you'll learn.
You have to commit to learn that amount of pages, of folios in Talmud, and that's what the bidding process is for.
How much did it go for?
Well, in America it started, went 500, 700, 750, 1,000. It kept on going up. 1,500, 2,000. Now, mind you, someone's going to say, okay, great, you know, I'll do Chazara. I'll learn one blot, and
correct.
I'll do it.
Keep going.
You can only, the same blot, you can only Chazar four times.
That's
for
it.
This plan, yeah. So that means, okay, so.
We're putting a cap
right,
on the Torah study.
Okay. So, in the end, America topped out at 3,200 blots.
Wow.
3,200 blot gemara. That's 6,400 amudim.
Very impressive.
Extremely impressive. The person, a Kleisenberger chassid from Union City, bought it. And not everyone realized that, you know, and everyone's hush. And
right.
Yeah, because no one realized who bought it. And then they call up for the aliyah. And they call up Rav David Hofstetter. He gave him the aliyah.
The head of Dershow.
Yeah. The place was silent. I mean, you understand,
they appreciate what he's
done. Yeah. The man is creating a revolution here, and some people are seeing the results of this already now, and some may not see it for another 10, 20 years.
Right.
But that's, we tried to capture that in this book a little bit. But the fact is that there is a revolution, and this is what's going on.
And that's why tonight's so significant, because it's the end of the first cycle. It's the end of the first time around.
Which is a specific program, which I would love to talk more about, the Dafne Balacha.
Correct.
But just going back.
But they encourage.
Now I want to go back to England.
They encourage Torah study with accountability.
With accountability, exactly right.
That's why they had a Daf Yomi Siyum.
That's
they
correct.
Had it 2 years ago.
Right, because why else?
It's part of the whole Daf Yomi system,
correct.
Right?
In the UK, they also sold, this was their first Shabbos convention, so they sold Shlishi. All right, so the bidding process went, 1,500, 17, 18, 19, 2,000. In the end, it went for 2,200.
Right.
Okay, so U.S. wins. If you keep it track.
Right. Okay. USA, USA.
USA. Okay, but wait. Yeah. The story's not over.
Go ahead.
There's still a bottom of the ninth. Okay, so the Aliyah was sold, 2,200. Terrific. Okay, it was B'Shutfis. Two partners bought the Aliyah.
Right.
Okay, obviously only one could get it. Mm. Someone took the Aliyah. Great. Right. By the Misha Beirach, they added 1,000 blot. So UK wins.
As an additional as an additional.
So
Misha
UK
mother.
Was 3,400.
Oh, boy. USA in second place. Are we happy about the silver medal or not? How does it work? Do we get happy about that? I don't think
so. But this is what we're talking about. People that learn, there's no day, there's no night. They are so committed, and they take the chinas. And when I meet them, these people are such tzaddikim, and they're so sweet. And I meet them. Sometimes they come over and thank me. Say, Yitzchak, you give me chizuk when you do the ads. I'm like, it's old Rav David Hofstadter. It's his vision. It's his dream. There's a real revolution taking place.
Are there different levels in the testing?
Yes.
There are different
levels.
Yeah,
and I can
add something. So there is a simpler level.
There are different levels of testing. Well, right. Even the lowest level is
it's not
advanced.
Easy, right.
But every time there's a new cycle, if someone took tests in a previous cycle, they have to commit to a higher level on the next level.
Really?
On the next right. Those that took Bechinas on Shas the last round, if they continue taking it, they have to, like, if let's say they didn't take it with Taisvis the first time, they have to add Taisvis. Because Rav David wants constantly the people should grow and grow. It's constantly driving them.
Seems like he thinks of everything. Information, by the way, to sign up for the daily e-newsletter, to sign up and see if there's a specific shear in your community, and to get any information, it's 8885-DEERSHOE, 8885-DEERSHOE. You also encourage people to use the email address, which is which I had a moment ago. Where's the email address? It's
Info
at
koleldeershoe.org.
Info at koleldeershoe.org.
I'm sorry about that,
no
Malcolm. My bad.
Info at koleldeershoe.org. Two L's in the middle of kolel.
Yes.
Info at koleldeershoe.org. Here's what it sounded like when Rabbi Friend, who everyone in this audience I'm sure has heard of, He addressed the UK.
That's correct.
This was what, Saturday night?
Saturday night.
All right, here's our right friend as he addressed the United Kingdom gathering for the Deershoe World Seum. You're listening to JM in the AM.
I've spent the Shabbos with Rav David Hofstadter. It's the first time I met him. We got a chance to schmooze here and there. I think that he's also motivated by the Pasuk, Lo Sishakach Mipizarei. But he has another twist on it. Sishakach Mipizarei also means on the Medaf Gedenken de Torah. You can't forget the Torah. Medaf Lernen de Torah, Medaf Esfar. Gedenk, you have to remember it. And that's what motivates him, and that's what's behind Deershoe. Nishnar Lernen, but to know what we learn and to be responsible for it. And that's his kiyum, Shokach Mipizare. Tonight is not only the siyum of the Mishnah Brura and the Deershoe program, but tomorrow is the beginning. We start Arachaim Chelek Aleph Simen Aleph, Sif Aleph. But if you really want to start at the beginning, and I would urge everybody to do this, is to read the Hakdamah of the Mishnah Berurah. The Mishnah Berurah only has two Hakdamahs to the six Chalokim of the Mishnah Berurah, Chelek Aleph and Chelek Gimel. In this Hakdamah, the Chelek Aleph, it's a wide-ranging Hakdamah. The Mishnah Berurah talks about many different things. But in one of those paragraphs, the Chofetz Chaim writes as follows. In spite of the fact that whatever a person learns, even if it's not negeya bismanenu kochim and tyrus, avaris mekayim with every vort and mitzvah sasei deraisa, mikol makayim, here's the lashon of the Chofetz Chaim verbatim. Iker limud ha'adam tzir arech liyais belimin hamevi lidei maisa. The Chofetz Chaim says, paskins, that the iker limud of a person has to be in things that halacha l'maisa, hamevi lidei maisa. And to wit, the Chofetz Chaim marshals the famous Gemara Masechta Brachos, Omar Av Chizda, Mai Dichsiv, Oyev Hashem, Sharei Tzion, Mikol Mishkan Es Yankiv, Zot Gemara, Oyev Hashem, Shorim Hamutzionim Bahalocha, Yaser Mibote Knesias, Mibote Midrashais. That Ribbono Shelom Hot Leave, the Ribbono Shelom loves the Sha'orim Mitzuyonim Bahalocha, the places where we learn Halocha L'maisa. The Marshal over there often Arden that Gemara explains that in fact, in spite of the fact that the Batei Knesiyos and the Bamit Roshes are full of people, they're learning all over, they're learning Kodshim, they're learning Tyrus, they're learning Zikin, they're learning Noshim. They're chock full of people learning Tyra. But nevertheless, there's something that is even more precious to the Ribbono Shel'olam, and that is the Sha'orim Mitzuyonim B'Halacha. The place that Talmidei Chachamim gather to learn Halacha L'maisa. That is what the Ribbono Shel'olam loves even more than the Batei Knesiyos and the Batei Midrashos that are also learning. Aber was macht the Ribbono Shel'olam zufrieden is the Sha'orim Mitzuyonim B'Halacha. Now with this, the Marshal goes on to explain the next line of the Gemara. V'ha'ayna dom rabchia bar avami, mishmei da'ula, miyayim shechar beis ha-migdash. Now the day beis ha-migdash was destroyed. Ein loy la'akadish baruch hu boi lomai, el ha-dalad amish o halacha b'vod. That from the time the beis ha-migdash was destroyed, ein loy la'akadish baruch hu boi lomai, el ha-dalad amish o halacha. Zok de marshah, that when the Beis HaMikdash was Kayim, the Sanhedrin HaGadol sat in the Lishkas HaGozis, and they paskin Halacha L'maisa, Umisham Yatza Haroli Yisrael. And if, as the Gemara tells us, there's nothing more precious to the Ribbono Shel'olam than the place where Halacha L'maisa is learned, that must include the Lishkas HaGozis. It's Kaviyochol, the Ribbono Shel'olam's favorite part of the Beis HaMikdash. But what happened when the Beis HaMikdash was destroyed? And there was no more Lishkas HaGozis. Zoch de Gemara. You know what the Ribbono Shel'olam likes now instead of the Lishkas HaGozis, instead of the Beis HaMikdash? The Arba Amishal Halacha, where we sit and we learn Halacha L'maisa. That's what the Ribbono Shel'olam hotliv more than anything else. The Ponovitch Rav Zeger Tzadik Levracha once said that one can learn this Gemara and think that when the Beis HaMikdash was Kayim, the Shechina was there. But now, there's no Beis HaMikdash. So Nebuch, the Ribbono Shel'olam had to settle. He had to settle for somewhere. Zok the Ponovitch Rav, nein! That's not the Pshat in the Gemara. The Ribbono Shel'olam didn't settle at all. It was always the mokum of the Ashkoras Hashchina was because of the Lishkas HaGozes, because Misham Yatza Hayroli Yisrael. That's what the Ribbono Shel'olam, that was the Siba for the Ashkoras Hashchina. And now that there's no Beis HaMikdash, the place where they sit and they learn Halacha L'maisa, that's the pseudo, the facsimile of the Lishkas HaGozes. When Rav Sadia Goyen was asked that he was appointed to the Rashiva in Sur, he was living in Egypt, he was living in Mitzrayim, and he became the Rashiva in Sura, in Babylonia, in Bovel, in Iraq. So before assuming his role as Rashiva, he did what all Rashivas have to do. He started collecting money. And he went to a Gvir in Egypt, and he asked him for a donation to the yeshiva in Sura. So this Gvir gave him a big dinava, a big donation. And he said, one t'nai. I want that the base, the Oren Kodesh in Sura should be named after me. There should be a plaque that I donated the Oren Kodesh, Oren HaKodesh, in the yeshiva in Sura. Rav Sadia Gaon agreed. He comes to Sura, and lo and behold, the Oren Kodesh is already donated. So what to do now? Should he return the money? See if the man would settle for something else? Rav Sadia Gaon wrote back to Egypt and he said, the Oren HaKodesh is where the Torah Shebichtav is kept. But what's the Oren HaKodesh for the Torah Shebaal Peh? But Rav Sadia Gaon gesagt, where a yeshiva bocher sits and learns, sein Ständer, his table, that's the Oren HaKodesh of the Torah Shebaal Peh, b'chol mokem shehu. And therefore you're getting the Oren HaKodesh. And that's perhaps what the Marsha means. There's no Beis HaMikdash today. And by Venisein HaRabim, there's no Lishkas HaGozis. But where halacha lemaisa is learned, everywhere that halacha lemaisa is learned, that's the lishkas hagozis, and that's what the Gemara means. Yeim shechara beis hamigdash, ein lo laakadosh baruch hu boi lomai, la dalad amish halacha bilvod. And because there is nothing more chavi to the Ribbono Shel than halimud halacha lemaisa, we can only imagine the enduring schus of the Chofetz Chaim Zecher Tzadik Livracha, because he made Or HaChaim accessible to the masses. You've learned the Halakim of Shulchan Aruch. You've learned Yeradeya. You've learned Chai Shem Mishpat maybe. Do you know how hard it is? How hard it is to figure it out? To have to matetzich on a shach, on a taz. It's Or HaChaim is different. Not because it's easier, but because the Mishnah Berura made it open to everybody. And on the other Halakim Shulchan Aruch, there is no Mishnah Berura. And for that we suffer. If I may be so bold to say, I think that the most important Chibur in the last 100 years is the Mishnah Berura. If you want to argue with that, you can speak to me afterwards. If it's not the most important, it's from the top three. Because he opened up Or HaChaim to Yeder Yid. And it wasn't easy. The Chofetz Chaim had many people working on the Mishnah Berura. He even had readers. The Chofetz Chaim, after he wrote the Mishnah Berura, would have people sit there and read back the Mishnah Berura to him so he could distinguish if it's clear, if it's not clear. Sometimes you write something down, but you don't know how it's going to be read, how it's going to be heard. So the Chofetz Chaim had people who sat there, read back the Mishnah Berura to him so that he would know that this would be easy for people to understand.
Some of the presentation that Rabbi Friend or Rabbi Yisachar Friend made this past Motzei Shabbos, this past Saturday night in the United Kingdom at the Dirshu World Seum that took place there at their convention over this past weekend. Okay, what do you want to go? Some music? Okay, we're going to go to Stan back in our studio with some music, and then we're going to reconnect from Israel live and more coming up from Tel Aviv. You want me to play music as well? Okay, and then more coming up from Tel Aviv here at JM in the AM. You're listening to our presentation from the Dirshu World Seum, which is taking place in Tel Aviv tonight here at JM in the AM. Okay. comes from the original Deer Shoes CD here at JM and the AM. I'm told that our video is now up at NahumSiegel.com. And a special thank you to Dennis here at the arena, at the Menorah Miftachim Arena in Tel Aviv, because he made sure that now our connection is as strong as ever. So big thank you to him, and a big thank you to Josh Melman at Travel Cell. We are now connected as strong as can be. And you can watch the video at NahumSiegel.com. We're live right now on a Tuesday. You can watch the video at NahumSiegel.com. Yitzchak Saflos is with me. We just heard from Rabbi Fran. That was in the United Kingdom. We're going to go to Diane Abrams, who spoke in South Africa. You were in South Africa for the Deer Shoe World Seum event that took place there. That was what night again? That was Wednesday, right?
Wednesday,
that was
March 18th, yeah.
And what was that like? I mean, we get a certain type of feel about what Jews in Paris and in the United Kingdom are going through. Tense situations both, you know, a little bit different, but both very tense situations. What's happening with the Jewish community in South Africa?
Well, it's interesting. Rav David, first of all, of course, I thank him for everything and for allowing me to play a small role in getting the word out about the amazing programs of Deir Shum. But he said, Yitzchak, for South Africa, you don't have to come along.
Oh, so you weren't there?
So, no. So
I apologize.
I went straight from America to England. But I'm
already completely you're doing so many Siyum, I'm confused who's where.
The South African Siyum was very, very special because the community there, and in fact, soon we'll hear from Diane Abrams,
right,
where he talks about the community, and he has a very interesting line. He says, people sometimes knock it because 90% are Bali Tshuva. And he talked about how beautiful and how precious that is. These Bali Tshuva Tzaddikim, look where they came from. Look how great. And yet Deir Shu's goal is to now take them to the next level.
Right.
Learn with accountability. So it was a very, very special evening. In fact, a special shout out to Rabbi Tabak, who ran that one, really ran a very, very beautiful program.
I'm sure people are curious in this audience. How many people come to an event like that in South Africa?
So a different one. The South African event, I believe, was around 750, if I recall correctly. England. Now, by the way, England does not have these type of events.
Right. They're not
it's
known
very
for
very
right.
rare. And that's why the event itself, which had 500 people for Shabbos.
Right.
And then 500 additional people coming on a mitzvah and late. You know, England runs late.
Yeah, Shabbos is over at midnight.
Yeah, the event started. In fact, there was a part of the part that was we didn't have a chance to play from Rabbi Friend. Rabbi Friend said to Rabbi Hofstadter, he says, do you think I'm going to get to speak before 1 a.m.? So Rabbi Hofstadter said, yeah, American time.
Not England time.
So that was so the event in South Africa was a very, very special event. It was a tremendous amount of chizuk, and they say that a lot of Dafi Yomi Bahalocha programs are going to be going to begin with this new machzor, the second cycle.
Pretty amazing. We're here in Tel Aviv. Both Jerusalem and Tel Aviv have the Deir Shoe World Seum celebrations tonight. It's happening tonight. We are here in the arena. These are the words of Diane Abrams, which were recorded in that South African presentation back on the 18th of March. Here's what he has to say about the Deir Shoe World Seum, and you're listening to JM in the AM.
Vayishma Yisrael. Yisrael didn't just hear. He listened. He heard and he listened. We can hear and we can turn over, knock the alarm clock and go back to sleep. Vayishma. Are we listening? Can we afford not to listen? You know, we had the great privilege of being here in the summer. Our summer, your winter. I'll swap our summer for your winter anyway. And I heard repeatedly the problem of South African Jewry. The problem. The problem is that over 90% of the observant community are Bali Jew. Problem? Problem? Problem that I stand in a community of such tzaddikim? Do you know how envious we are in the world of what you're doing, what you are doing, what you've done, and what you're continuing to do? Problem that 90% plus are families who become inspired to take on Torah to a greater degree than their parents. Is that a problem? Do you know what a privilege you have? Do you know how great you are? Do you know what an incredible community you sinners around the world, a community who listens. Problem? Shabbos project from your chief rabbi, a problem? The biggest bracha of the last year, Anglo Jewry, World Jewry, the Shabbos project in the world. That's what you're doing when you listen. You have that unique achdus, that unique unity, that unique sense of belonging because you have a shared kavod ha-Torah, or perhaps more correctly, kavod ha-Torah, as you say. But it's because of the wonderful legacy of Litter, or Russia, or wherever. What you preserved is an incredible sense of respect for Torah and its scholars, irrespective of the particular level of observance. You've kept your love over respect for and admiration for Torah and learning at a level which unites your community, which brings 6,000 people to a Sinai in Dava and guarantees that the glorious revival of this beautiful community. Because you have that Kvod HaTorah, which is the magic of your Achdus. I have my dear, dear friend, Gideon Fox here. We know what Australia was like, and we know divisions and communities. It's a wonderful community as well, Australia. I don't mean to say specifically there. But there are all sorts of divides, Svarad, Ashkenaz, Chassidish, non-Chassidish, the Babich, Mizrahi, every Hebrew has their own label. One chief rabbi, one based in one sense of community, because of one sense of shared identity through Kavod HaTorah. You are a community who are listening. But that's your challenge, as you heard from Rabbi Hofstadter as well. I should have spoken before you. A simple challenge, Rabbi Isaac. Think about the glory of the scholarship of the Chofetz Chaim, of Reb Chaim, of Kelm Kletz Slabodke Mir, of Malat, of Bialystok. Think about all the names your grandparents and great-grandparents rattled off. And think about the legacy of grandparents waiting to be taken by their grandchildren and great-grandchildren. Grab it because it's your legacy. It's your heritage. Your Kvod HaTorah, your respect, your love, and your preservation of that respect through generations where they were challenged and they not have been able to be so observant, as you heard from Rabbi Kosofsky. Communities which were far flung and lost that ability at times to practice. But that Kvod HaTorah, that love of Torah, that love of Torah scholarship never departed. It's your legacy. Mishnah Brura belongs here more than anywhere else. Because it's your grandparents and great-grandparents in Litva, in Ruslan, to have that mysterious Nevesh and love of Torah which is serving to this community. Listen, take it, seize it. I'm not talking about the World Cup. Seize it, this is your time. And build your future with it. That's the challenge of Ayishma, of your listening. If you're being the great community you've had, you've made yourselves, and the challenge you've created for yourselves in how you go to the next step of becoming a model community of scholars, of people who know what they do, why they do it, and how. Because their Kvod HaTorah, their honor of Torah, has led them to love Torah and inculcate their lives, your lives, and your children's lives with Torah. And I'm not talking about any of those, but there are growing numbers among this community. We're fortunate to learn in wonderful schools and yeshivas, kollelim, here and abroad. I'm talking about the fathers and parents, and the programs of women as well to learn halacha, who may not have been blessed with the same education. Don't lead and live your lives through your children. Lead and live it through yourselves. You take on these programs and these projects, and we'll see how you'll grow and how you'll be infused in your midst. Let me tell you a short nice, if I may, a short story. That's where I better. I think you'll agree that this is the true story about listening. There was a young man from the Midwest in America, a Gentile background. His parents had come from Europe. They moved to the Midwest. Christian, mildly so, but Christian all the same. And he had a winter, December break. He went to the Big Apple to New York. He wanted to visit various areas after seeing the sights, and at that time the World Trade Center was still standing, Empire State. One of the sites he was told was to see Williamsburg and the Hasidim. And he got in the train, into a train, I'm told, in Manhattan. And as the doors closed, he suddenly had a panic attack. Sitting opposite him was a living, breathing, moving Hasidic specimen. And he sure didn't know what to do. Baruch Hashem, this fellow had some sechel. Thank God he had a bit of understanding, and he broke the ice, maybe the thick level of fear, started talking. The Chassid engaged in a conversation. What brings you here? From the Midwest. Well, you come here, obviously, from the Chassidim. So he says, where are you from? It's the Midwest. What's your name? And he gave him a name. And he said, you're Christian, are you? He said, I know people in my community in Williamsburg and Sutton with the same name. No, it can't be. He said, you know, I think you may have a Poland. Where in Poland? No, it's all right. He says, you may be Jewish. No, it's all right. He said, do me a favor. If ever you want to check it out, go to yeshiva and check it out. He took out a card, and he wrote down his name. He wrote down yeshiva, he put Ar Samech, a couple of other yeshivas, and he gave it to the fellow. The fellow slid into his jeans, jumped off on the next stop, went straight back and didn't go any closer to Williamsburg at all. 6 months later, he did a tour of the Middle East, was in Jordan, Sela Adom, Dead Sea, Red Sea, Eilat, finds himself at a Katel, the wall. People swaying at the wall, he puts on a kippah, starts swaying at the wall. The fellow comes up to him, Rabbi Shuster, and says, you want to go to yeshiva? Oh, never heard that before. Apparently he's wearing the same pair of jeans 6 months later. So he puts hands in his pocket, and he goes, Or Smek? She says, Or Smek? He didn't ask him for some reason, probably looked Jewish. He took him to Or Smek. And this guy walked in. Can we help you? He said, I've learned a bit about Judaism. I told the yeshiva. He said, actually, somebody gave me this card, so I should check that I am Jewish. They cared a lot, so as things transpired, a few days later, they did their research, found out, sure enough, he's Jews can be, his grandparents were Jewish, the sheikh they came from, his mother was Jewish, his father was probably also Jewish. Both sides. And he's an Ur Samech. A few days later, our new Jew calls up his old Christian dad. He called him up from Ur Samech. He said, hi, Dad. He said, where are you, son? I'm in Jerusalem. Where? I'm in yeshiva. What are you doing there? He said, Dad, why didn't you tell us? He said, son, get out of there and stand the phone down. He called a couple of days later, being in yeshiva still. He was learning Hebrew reading and a bit about the basics of faith. His father, having calmed down somewhat, says, son, you're making the mistake of your life. Mum and I, we're both survivors, the children of survivors as little kids. And we came to America and we met and we decided, determined to make sure that our children would never go through anything remotely like that. So we blended into our community and we brought you up as part of the community in America. Come back and save your life. Sorry, Dad, I'm not coming back until I can learn more about my Judaism. My boy said, please listen to this. 2 weeks later, a package came to the yeshiva, addressed to this young man. And he opens the package, which was sent from his father, unwraps it and finds an old brown book in it, written in Hebrew. He wasn't adept enough in reading Hebrew, but he took it to the rabbi. Rosh Yeshiva opens it, sees the covering letter that his father had sent, opens to the Shaar Blat, or the introductory page, which contains information about the nature of the book, and promptly bursts into tears. He says, Rabbi, why are you crying? He said, I'll translate for you, my friend, what this book says. This book was written by your great-grandfather, so your father says. It was the only vestige of Judaism which he kept as part of an inheritance in the family. And this is what the introductory page says. I write this book in Russia. This sefer, not because I'm the biggest Talmid Chacham, not because I'm the most learned scholar, and not because the world necessarily needs this book or this sefer, but I see the Ruchais Hazman, I see the winds of change. I'm worried about my children, what Judaism they will have. I'm worried whether my grandchildren will want to be Jewish. And I'm worried that my great-grandchildren may not even know they're Jewish. So I'm writing this saying for that if in any time in the future, my lineage has a doubt about their Jewish origins, they should know they had a Sabo, a grandfather or great-grandfather who learned Torah and loved Torah, and this is your heritage. Rabbeisa, you'll say this and help to say this. Help to say this. The generations of the past in litter, and those who saw children come here or go to America and lose out that Messiah, what worries they had. If we listen, this will be the consolidation, the confirmation of that voyage of despair being turned into the greatest journey of hope, growth, and greatness for Klal Yisrael. If you listen to the calls of sages waiting for us, all of us, to take the inheritance back and give it through our lives to our children. We have no excuses. Once again, we have a Godel. Rabbi Hofstetter, his wife, and all those who are behind him have given us this opportunity. And we merit to take that opportunity with two hands, to listen, commit ourselves, half an hour a day, 25 minutes a day, and those who find it difficult in Hebrew of Imagination, and use the tremendous message that this community sends out around the world to be the model of a growing community, growing in Torah, growing in connecting the future to the glories and wonders of the past. If you do, I have no doubt at all that you will be the community which leads the rest of the world, the Kabbalah Pnei Moshiach, to welcome Moshiach back when the Zaydis and Bobas in heaven will rejoice that the children have been safely escorted back to Yerushalayim. The Beis Hamikdash shall be rebuilt with the glow of Torah emanating from that menorah, when every boy and girl will be not only clear and proud, will delight in that heritage, will be united with Hashem in true peace, Yerushalayim Habnuyam.
Good morning.
There you go. Sorry about that. I want to thank Diane Abrams, and I really want to thank ZK, who just caught that for a moment. It's America's one and only Jewish Moments in the Morning radio program, heard on listener-sponsored WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, Rockland County at 91.9 on the FM dial, around the world on the web, jmdam.org. Here with Yitzchak Saflis, we're live in Tel Aviv as we broadcast from the Deer Shoe World Seal, and this is where the event's going to be happening tonight. You'll hear the actual event on our radio show tomorrow morning as we have this two-day celebration going on JM and the AM. And plenty more coming up. As you mentioned, Rabbi Yitzchak Saflis, Rav David Hofstetter, is the Nasi. He is the head. Yes. He is the founder and head of the entire Deer Shoe organization. He had an opportunity to address the Deer Shoe World Seum Tour back in the United Kingdom.
That's correct. He spoke Moitz Shabbos at that. It was a gala Malava Malka. They had it was a one-piece band, but with five singers and a lead singer. It was very, very uplifting, the entire program. Of course, Rav David Hofstetter spoke, Rabbi Fran spoke. Diane Abrams actually spoke a little bit there as well, even though he spoke in South Africa, because he lives in England. So he came, he was so inspired.
He gave
inspired.
Him a double workload, I see.
Yeah, he came, he was just so inspired by what's going on. He said, I had to join you again.
Right. Here are the words of Rav David Hofstetter from that appearance in the United Kingdom.
Yeah, and if I could share, sure. He even discussed something that was like very near and dear to him, which is why, what motivates Rav David Hofstetter? Look what he's doing for Klal Yisrael. What motivates him? And he actually shared that in this presentation.
Here it is. We'll hopefully get the entire segment in this segment here at JM and the AM, and then more coming up, of course, on a Tuesday morning broadcast. Rav David Hofstetter, the founder of Deer Shoe at JM and the AM.
Meshus. Meshus harabonim achashuvim shlita. Meshashiva shlita. Meshus hamasaimim. Chavrei Dirshu, Kol HaKol HaKodesh Hazeh, Shnishtatfu, Der Malav Malka, L'Chvoid HaSiyum, L'Chvoid HaTayra, L'Chvoid Rebbeinu Shalom. Noch Hazah Heilige Shabbos, Aruch Nisdike Shabbos, Gehoibene Shabbos, Man kann verstehen, der Werte von der Heilige Orachaim HaKodesh sagt, als Shabbos ist nicht nur ein Yom Menucha, Menucha ist ein Nefesh, Menucha ist ein Guf. Shabbos ist nicht nur der Mekor HaBrocha, aber Shabbos ist der Mekor HaChaim. The Mekor from the Chiyus from the ganze Welt. The world could not exist without Shabbos. The Kayach and the Bria would only take us until a Shabbos. Without a Shabbos to rejuvenate the Welt, to bring new Kayachas into the Welt, the world would not be able to exist. And with Kayach from Azar Shabbos, and Azovi, the Rebbe Shlit had gesagt, the Kayach from Asiyum, we should draw from this Kayach to start fresh, start new, a new machzer, a new limud in Mishnah Brura, Baruch Asher Yakim es Divra HaTorah HaZayis, to raise up the banner of the Torah, the Kavod HaTorah, to start a new machzer, in Anaya Daf HaYomi, an Andra Daf HaYomi, Anaya Daf HaYomi in Klal Yisrael, a Daf HaYomi Bahaloch in Klal Yisrael. And after with this kayach, we can have the chokhmah and the bina, the das, to try to understand some of the events that are taking place in the world around us, that are swirling around in the world in the last kufa, Rahmana Litzlan, the tzoras, the Ribui and Sinas Yisrael in the last Kufa, to try to understand with Chochmah, with introspection and sensitivity, what the Rebbeinu Shel Olam is asking from us. Avada, it's a time of Tzila. So come to uns nor der Mann, as uns zenen in Golos, and medav davenen, like the Geula Shleima, and be us a Mashiach. Oder efshir likdo noch a tifa mashmois. In the Parsha and Parsha Shaifti, when Klal Yisrael was going out to Melchama, the Torah says, Al yarech levavchem v'al tarzu mipneihem. Don't fear your enemies. The first thing is to know is not to fear. Not that pachat. Ki Hashem lekechem ahoylech imochem lilochem lachem imoyveichem lo yishiyaschem. The Rebbeinu Shel Olam is with us. The Rebbeinu Shalom protects us. When Klal Yisrael goes out to Melchama and it's an Eitz Zara, they have to remember always that the Rebbeinu Shalom is with us. But the Ramban says, the Ramban, Shteitin Ramban, is Nachdu and Nacha Mashmois from the Pasuk. The Pasuk is teaching us something else, that the Rebbeinu Shalom is with us. And then we go out to Melchama, we have to know that it's not Kaych V'yotzim Yodi. Whatever our Yishtadlis is, that's the Rebbeinu Shel Olam. The time when it is a time of Melchama and Eitz Tzara, it's a time when the Rebbeinu Shel Olam draws us close. We become closer to the Rebbeinu Shel Olam, but it's upon us to be aware of that and always to keep that in mind. In Shnas Tafresh Pei Ches was a year where there were calamities in Klal Yisrael, and in the ganze Welt, there were natural disasters, earthquakes, fires, etc. And the Chofetz Chaim Zatzal, Zchus HaYagin Aleinu, wrote an Igeres on Erev Yom Kippur, a famous Igeres, where he wrote and he asked the question, how are we to interpret these events in our Tkufa when there's no Nevi'im? When we don't have the Nevi'im to tell us what the Rotzon Hashem is, we don't have a Yirmiyahu Novi to carry the Dvar Hashem. So how do we interpret these events around us? So the Chofetz Chaim said, Ma atan nirdam, lama atem yishenim, why are you shluffing? Why are you sleeping? Do you know who are the Nevi'im in our Tkufa? You know who are the Shluchei D'Rachmana in our Tkufa? The Pasuk in Tillim says, Oysa malach avruchas mishors of eish loyet, the winds, the fire. They are the Shluchim of the Rebbeinu Shel Olam to tell us, to teach us to do tshuva. And it would be very convenient and very easy to attribute the calamities only to those who are not Shemir Torah Mitzvahs. It would be very easy to say, and those who are the ones who are Nilchem against Torah, who fight against Torah, and attribute all the problems in Klal Yisrael to them. That would be very convenient and very easy. But my river Abaisai, the Rabbeinu Shel Olam sends messages. In the Tkufa, when there is no Nevuah, the Rabbeinu Shel Olam sends messages with the Ruchais, and with the Mayim, and the Eish. But Rachmana Litzlan, the Eish, and the Cherev, has come into Afilo, the Shayorim HaMetzuyonim B'Halocha, even into the Bati Midrashas. So maybe there's something, that's a message from the Rabbeinu Shel Olam that he's telling us that there's something chaser in our learning, in our tefillah. The fire, the gunfire has reached even these mekaymes, even the places, the fire that has come into the places where people go and buy food for Shabbos, even to the houses, Rachmana Litzlan, which we just heard a few hours ago, the houses of Shemir Shabbos, from food that's being prepared for Shabbos. And maybe there's a message that there's something lacking in our Shmiras Halacha, in our Shayorim HaMetzuyonim B'Halacha, in our Shmiras HaShabbos and Shmiras Halacha. Maybe our Limud HaTorah, there's something missing there. If there's an Eish, if there's a fire from Sinai Yisrael Rachmana Litzlan, maybe it's a response to a fire, to a fire of Sinas Yisrael, of Sinas Chinam. Maybe there's something lacking in our Avas Yisrael. Maybe we have to be Mizarez ourselves, to strengthen ourselves, to learn the halachas of Loshon Hara and Sinas Chinam, and to foster Avas Chinam in Klal Yisrael. As I said, that is in unser Zeit, the Ruach Ra von Sinus Yisrael, the schreckliche fire from the Reitzchim in the Shvera Parsingon über die ganze Welt, they sind in the Schluchim from Rebbeinu Shel Olam. Und zum Eir sein und der Mannen zu Tshuvatzon, sei jeder einer für sich allein, sei gerade ganz klar Yisrael, sich mit Skarif sein zu HaKadosh Baruch Hu, lies Davik Boi Yves HaYrosa. Perhaps there's a message that we have to strengthen our Torah, to bring it l'maisa, to know what the Rabbeinu Shalom wants from us, to learn Torah with a geshmak, but to learn Torah always in mind, what is it that the Rabbeinu Shalom is asking from us, to strengthen our Avas Yisrael. As was mentioned earlier, we're in the Tkufa before Bias HaMashiach, in Achras HaYomim. It's a special Tkufa right now. It says, Chodesh Nisan, the Chodesh of Geula, it's Shnas HaShmita, Matzoy Shvias Ben David Bo. Chofetz Chaim wrote in a letter in Tov Resh Tzadi Aleph that Shnas HaShmita, Seif Shnas HaShmita is the Zman of Yisairis, when there's Yisairis from Almala, that if Klal Yisrael would be Chayzer B'Tshuva, be Miskarav to the Rebbeinu Shel Olam, then even if they're not on the Madrega or the Biroi for Bias HaMashiach, they'd be Zeicha to the Geula. And everybody for years have been asking, when will the Geula come? When will Mashiach come? But my rabbi say, I think I know when Mashiach will come. I know because it was told to me by one of the greatest gedolim in Klal Yisrael. The pasuk in Netzavim says, V'shavt ad Hashem lekecha v'shamata b'koyla k'chol asher anoichi mitzav chayoyim atu v'anecha v'chol avavcha v'chol nafshecha. Zog the Ramban that the Geula will come. That the Geula will come when Klal Yisrael takes upon themselves to accept the mitzvahs of Hashem. To take upon themselves when they accepted the mitzvahs of Hashem, just like they did at the time of Ezra, at the time of Nehemiah, by Golus Bavel, and they were makabel on themselves all mitzvahs, and they were zeichet to the Geula. Now we know that there were vast, vast sections of Klal Yisrael did not come up and were not oila with Ezra Teretz Yisrael. Great, vast portions of Klal Yisrael did not come. So l'chera, the meaning is that those who were faithful to Hashem, but they took upon themselves the oila Teretz, that chevra, that group, that kehillah of those who were oila, but they took upon themselves to be chorei l'dvar Hashem, to be mekabel himself, the olam mitzvahs, and with a Kabbalah to know, to want to know, to learn, to be mekayim, the rotzon Hashem, they were zeichet to the geula. And therefore, the primary responsibility is on the lomdei Torah. The lomdei Torah, those who are charedim l'dvar Hashem, to take upon himself the kiyum ha-mitzvahs of Gantz, the Gantz, the Torah kula. Kish echad, b'lev echad, with avas Yisrael, and the koyach of Kabbalah's ha-mitzvahs, through thick and thin, has the power to bring a geula. We can leave this Shabbos, and we can leave this Malava Malka with a feeling of Chizuk and Isairus. But unless we leave with a feeling of a mission, that the Ribbono Shel'Olam is speaking to us and is telling us, and we take upon ourselves a mission to create a new Daf Hayomi, to create a Kabbalah of all mitzvahs in Klal Yisrael, of Avas, Chinam, and Klal Yisrael, then we are missing our calling. Vayikra, we learned Vayikra with the small Aleph, the Aleph Zeira. We all know the Balat Turim and many Pshatim that were said. Just add one more Pshat in Vayikra. We also lain in Chodesh Nisan, we lain about the Chanukah Samizbeach, the Nesiim. The Mishkan was built by Bezalel. The Pasuk says, Ru Karasi B'Shem, Bezalel Ben Uri Ben Chur Lamata Yehuda, Karasi B'Shem, I called him. Rav Moshe Zatzal asked the Kasha, where do we see that there was a Kriya? Where do we see that there's a Kriya to Bezalel? We never see that in the Pasuk. Ayin Sham and Rav Moshe. But actually we can say the pshat is that every yid has a calling, and his neshama knows what the calling is. And Moshe Rabbeinu Vayikra, Moshe Rabbeinu was called by the Ribbono Shel Olam. It was a calling that he had, it was a love, only he heard it, no one else heard the voice, only he heard that sound, and it was a resounding, thunderous sound, Kol Hashem B'Koyach. But only Moshe Rabbeinu heard it. But it's written with a small aleph, because every person has the bechira not to hear that voice. Every person has the bechira and the nisoyan. There is a sound, a powerful, resounding voice that's calling out to each and one, each and every one, to fulfill his tafkid. But he has the Bechira and he has the Nisoyan, and it's written with a small Aleph. It could be Kol Hashem B'Koyach. And it's speaking to you and only you, and you can ignore it. And as if it doesn't say Vayikra, but Vayakir. But if you have the Rotzen, the overwhelming desire to fulfill the Rotzen Hashem, then you'll hear the voice and you'll fulfill your tafkid and your mission. I just want to be Messiah with a Maisa Shehoya that demonstrates hearing a calling, that demonstrates the power of Kabbalah's mitzvahs to bring a Yeshua and a Geula, and explains why I'm here and the reason I'm able to be here tonight. The world at large is bemerking that it's 70 years from the liberation from the Holocaust. And both my parents, my in-laws, are sheiros haplata, Holocaust survivors. And around this time, shortly after Pesach, 70 years ago, my mother, Lo Shalom, was liberated. She was taken as a young girl, 16 years old, torn from her family and sent to Auschwitz, packed on a train, a cattle car, sent to Auschwitz. And from there, she endured the selection process and was taken to a labor camp in Allendorf, where they worked back-breaking avodas parach, sustaining themselves with a little piece of bread and what they called soup. And somehow, 70 years ago, right around this kufa, they became aware in the camp that Pesach was coming. And they chapta pachad. Pesach is coming, and all they have is a little bit of bread. And if they don't eat that bread, they'll starve. But how can you possibly eat chametz on Pesach? So my mother, Allah Shalom, with her cousin, decided that no matter what, they were not going to eat chametz on Pesach. But they couldn't refuse to eat it either, because if they didn't eat it, the Nazi guards, Yimach Shom, would beat them mercilessly. So they hid the chametz. They hid it, they put it away, so they wouldn't see it, they wouldn't eat it, and no one else would see it either. And somehow they managed, they survived through Pesach. Shortly after Pesach, the Allied bombers flew overhead and the camp was evacuated. And they began to march west on the infamous Death March. The Death March, where many collapsed and died from hunger, deprivation, starvation, and they died on the roads. And as they were being marched west to Niedergrinsbach, the Allied planes were flying overhead, and as they got close, suddenly they looked around and the guards had disappeared, and they were all alone. And they were, so to speak, free. But at that point, my mother had no more kayach. She was at the last of her strength. And they took her to a farmhouse where she stayed there for several weeks, until she recuperated and eventually got her strength back. She was at the very end, and if she had been one more day, then she would not have survived. But what allowed her and helped her to get to that end, to that last day, that fateful day, was on the evacuation of the camp in Allendorf. She had the presence of mind to look for that chometz that she hid before Pesach, and she found it, and she took it with her, and that's what saved her and sustained her on that death march. The Mesiras Nefesh for Kiyama Mitzvahs brought her the Yeshua and Geula. That's the koyach of Shmiras HaMitzvahs. And my rabbi said, if a 16-year-old girl taken to Auschwitz starving, can hear that voice, that Vayikra, that this is her mission, that right now this is the most important thing for her to do, this is her calling, and refuse to eat chometz on Pesach. And that brought the Geula and the Yeshua for her. And that's why I'm here tonight. I think each and every one of us has the capability, has the ability and the wherewithal to hear that calling, to hear that Vayikra, and to take it upon themselves to fulfill the Rotzon of the Ribbono Shel Olam. Let us all now join together to build a new Daf HaYomi in Klal Yisrael, that Klal Yisrael is thirsting for, a new Daf HaYomi, a Daf HaYomi of Limud HaLocha, Shmiras HaLocha, of Avas Yisrael, of Limud the Halochas of Loshon Hara, and Avas Yisrael, and Avas Chinam, to join together, Kish Echad, Belev Echad, to raise up a banner of a new Daf HaYomi in Klal Yisrael, a Shmir for Klal Yisrael, that will bring Geula and Yeshua to each and every one of us, Beprat, and Klal Yisrael as a whole, to Gans Klal Yisrael. We should overturn the tide of Sinah to Ava and bring Yeshuas and Geulas and Refuas, and we should be Zoicha to take a welcome in the Bias Goyal of Tui Hashem Yeshuvan Vod Sian Barina V'simchas Oilam Al Roisham Sosan V'simcha Yasigu V'nosu Yogan V'anocha Amen.
The words of Rabbi David Hofstadter, that is the presentation he made in the United Kingdom during the World Siyum Convention in the United Kingdom this past Mota Shabbos, obviously that was recorded. We're here at the Dershu World Siyum celebration at Yad Eliyahu Stadium in Tel Aviv. It's all going to be happening right behind us just hours from now, and of course happening in Yerushalayim at Binyanei HaOma as well. Only JM and the AM can go from Rabbi Hofstadter's words to our Yeshiva League sports update. We'll be back with Rabbi Goldwasser and then a special guest in our makeshift studio in Yad Eliyahu coming up. First, our Yeshiva League sports update on a Tuesday. Here is Elliot Weiselberg.
Thanks, Nachum. The 2014-2015 basketball season has come to its conclusion, which means that we only have one thing left to talk about, the granddaddy of them all, the Bernard Red Sarachek tournament. We have all the action from Championship Monday straight ahead on the final Yeshiva League Tuesday morning JM in the AM Sports Update. Good morning, I'm Elliot Weiselberg. The 24th annual Red Sarachek tournament took place this past weekend, presented in its usual fanfare at the Max Stern Athletic Center on the campus of Yeshiva University. 20 teams gathered from around the nation to participate, including 5 from our very own backyard. The Yeshiva League was represented by Hafter, DRS, and Frisch, the top 3 seeds in order, Hillel, seeded 9th, and MTA starting out play in the 15 slot. For 5 days, the teams did battle with the likes of Chicago's Ida Crown, Boca's Weinbaum, and the defending champion Panthers of Eula. When filling out your Sarachek Madness brackets, the Tier 1 semifinal on Sunday pitted the 4 teams that you probably would have expected to be there, our top 3 Yeshiva League teams, and Eula, with Yeshiva League champion Hafter drawing the California Kids, and a rematch of one half of the semifinal matchups in the Yeshiva League playoffs, DRS and Frisch. In the early game, Frisch avenged their semifinal upset from 2 weeks ago behind the play of Tyler Hode leading the team with 11 points, and despite the double-double effort of DRS's Gabriel Leifer, who posted 17 points and 14 rebounds. In the other semifinal, Hafter rode his triumvirate of A.B. Perlow, Max Rosner, and Jonathan Greenberg to a 51-37 victory. The 3 players alone tallied 39 points for the Hawks in the win. This set up a Championship Monday matchup between the 2 teams that most everyone expected to square off 8 days earlier, the top 2 rated teams for most of the year, the Frisch Cougars and the Hafter Hawks. From the outset, the capacity crowd knew that they were in for a thriller, but what transpired was probably much more than they bargained for. For much of the afternoon, the Cougars gave the Hawks fits, but Hafter was able to keep the game within range. However, the league champions found themselves down 6 with a few minutes left in the fourth quarter. But 2 clutch free throws from Sammy Mandel erased the Frisch lead to tie the game. Frisch would keep possession for the rest of the quarter, but would not convert, sending the game to overtime. for three of what will be some of the most debated overtimes over the next few months, Frisch played possession ball, milking the clock from the opening tip to almost the buzzer, doing exactly that for the entire 4 minutes of the second overtime, on which Frisch could not capitalize either. In the third extra session, however, the ball game resumed, and with just over a minute to go, the game was tied at 73 apiece. Frisch once again held for a final possession and set up isolation for Benny Tuchman to go one-on-one with Hafter big man Amy Perlow. Tuchman drove the lane as the clock wound down and laid in the game-winning bucket to give Frisch its first Tier 1 Saracek championship. Tuchman was one of four Frisch players to finish in double digits, with Tyler Hode, the tournament MVP, leading the way with 18. Perlow was the high scorer for Hafter, and the game dropping 26 points to accompany 14 rebounds. In other action, Ida Crown took home the Tier 2 championship, defeating Hillel 49-39. Weinbaum outlasted Maimonides 50-45 for the Tier 3 crown, and the 20th-seeded Akiva Day School from Michigan came back to upset host MTA in the Tier 4 title game 55-53. For more information on all Saracek action, tune in this coming week for the latest edition of the Court Report. Unfortunately, due to the very hectic and compact nature of the Saracek schedule, and combined with the fact that my focus has been on preparation for the upcoming middle school hockey championship game that my team, the Hartora Hattricks, will be participating in this coming Thursday night in North Shore, there will be no new Court Report tonight. I apologize to all of the dedicated listeners of the show, and promise that you will not be disappointed when the show airs next week. With Saracek's conclusion, that brings us to the close of the 2014-2015 regular season, and with it, the close of our regular weekly Tuesday morning segment. We will likely have some special segments following the All-Star events coming up over the next few weeks, and in the weeks surrounding the 10th annual Martin Weisselberg Memorial Hockey Tournament, but for now, our spot has drawn to a close. I'd like to thank Nachum for the opportunity to present this report each and every week for the last three seasons. But more importantly, I would like to thank all the fans, coaches, parents, and especially the participants of the Yeshiva League for taking center stage and putting on a show worthy of discussion. To all of our graduating seniors, thank you for sharing your 4 years with us, and we wish you the best in whatever your futures hold. For everyone else, the 2015-2016 season is right around the corner, and I can't wait to see what's in store. So, for the final time of the 2014-2015 season, that was your Tuesday morning JM in the AM Sports Update. I'm Elliot Weiselberg.
Elliot, I give you a lot of credit. A lot of people out there enjoyed your reports, as they do every single season. It's a big boost for us every Tuesday at JM in the AM, and it's much appreciated. Special guests coming up as we broadcast live on a Tuesday from the site of the Deershoe World Seum happening in Tel Aviv tonight. Actually, Tel Aviv and Yerushalayim. We're at Yad Eliyahu right behind us. They are preparing the arena for the big Torah celebration this evening. First, Rabbi David Goldwasser's words, Zechanish Masar of Zebin of Yosef Alevi. Here is Rabbi David Goldwasser with Morning Chizuk.
Good morning. Abai once said, "May I be rewarded for that when I saw a student that completed his tractate, I made a festive day for all of the scholars." The question is asked in the Sefer Oraisa, why was Abai particularly happy about the Siyum of one of his Talmidim? He had already learned Kol HaTorah Kula, the entire Torah, its length and its breadth. The Siyum that the Talmud made was only on one Masechta, one tractate. Why doesn't it say that Abai was happy with his own personal Siyum and made a Yom Tov then? It is apparent that the simcha one experiences for a student or for another person has to be even greater than our own personal simcha in regard to our own personal accomplishments. When we're concerned about the people around us, when we are concerned about the hatzlach of the people in our community, then the simcha is much greater than our personal one. Concerning Torah learning, we find the fascinating Tana d'Veilio. It states, Ein Yisrael Nigalin, the Jewish people will not be redeemed, lo mitoch tzar, not from trouble, v'lo mitoch shibud, not because of servitude, v'lo mitoch hatiltol, nor because we have to travel from place to place, v'lo mitoch adchak, not because of poverty, v'lo mitoch she'ein lemizonos, and not because they have no sustenance, elo mitoch asara b'nei adam, only because of 10 people, Shiyoshim Ze Eitzel Ze, that sit next to each other, V'yiyeh Kol Echod Mehem Koyre V'Shonim Chaveroi, and each of them sits and they learn together with their friends, V'Koylam Nishma, and their voice is heard. Rabbi Yeshaya Rosenberg once told Over that during the Second World War, he is with a group of Yidden who were on the run. They feared for their very lives at any moment. As they passed through a village, they were desperate for food. They noticed a garbage can, and they began to search through it for any morsel or scrap of food. To their great surprise, they discovered a page of the Talmud, something they hadn't seen for years, part of a daf from Maseches Shabbos. They saw the words, Tzion b'mishpat tipadeh, Tzion will be redeemed through justice, and they began to sing and rejoice. They understood this to be a direct sign from heaven that ultimately they would be liberated. The Rochav Arov tucked the page into his clothing. The small group studied that single page of Talmud over and over again. Indeed, ein mikra ba'alma, there is no coincidence, it was a sign. And those who had discovered the page emerged from the gates of Movis and survived the Holocaust. This has been Rabbi David Goldwasser, bringing you Morning Chizuk. Have a nice day.
JM in the AM. I wonder if Rabbi Nachman Seltzer remembers this selection. Does this sound familiar to you, sir?
A little familiar.
A little bit familiar? That's, of course, a piece of the... Let me stop it for a moment. A piece of the Shira Chadasha Boys Choir is one of the things that Rabbi Nachman Seltzer is responsible for. You read a lot of articles that he writes. You read novels that he writes. How many total things have you authored?
We have 20 books out right now.
You've authored 20 books?
20 books are published. We're in the process of a few more right now.
The most recent would be?
The most recent would be Inside Their Homes, published by Art Scroll, written in conjunction with a friend of mine, Rabbi Binyamin. We keep his last name anonymous.
Rabbi Binyamin.
But the idea is that he was close to many, many Gedolim. And the book is Inside Their Homes, his personal experiences and encounters with the Gedolim in America.
Unquote, private lives.
Right? In America, Eretz Yisrael, some are famous, some are not famous. Gedolim of Yerushalayim, Gedolim of America. Very interesting book, Baruch Hashem.
How long
really
ago
like
did that
it.
Come out?
That just came out a few months ago.
Very nice.
Hanukkah. Wow.
So if you look at the list of books you're responsible for, it would be a long one. People could search, and I'm sure they could find it.
Halavai Vaita, you know?
Yeah, that's for sure. You were there at the Deer Shoe celebration that happened in Paris, France, and we emphasized that as much as all these Siyumim are unbelievable, and every one of them has their own character, their own personality, you know how it is. What goes on in America is not the same what goes on in Great Britain, et cetera, et cetera. Paris must have been a really unique experience because of everything that the Parisian Jews and French Jews in general have been going through and are going through at this time. Would you say that really did, that whole theme seeped into the celebration that was going on in Paris?
Yes, for sure, definitely. So let's see, I've covered many of the events with conjunction with Rabbi Yitzchak over here and Bottom Line Marketing. We've done, you know, a few different things together. And being in France was something tremendous. I'll tell you why. So I'll give you an example. We go in the middle. It's all right, but Pesach Kron started the office. He spoke first. Right now, there was a gathering of French Rabbanim upstairs, and he was speaking, and the crowd is, even though he's speaking in Hebrew, mostly they speak French.
Right.
But Rabbi Kron doesn't need to speak. He can speak in any language, like Dvarma Yotzim and Alev, and they understand what he's saying, even if they need to be, for sure. So that right away, they kicked off the event to a great start. But in the middle, I mean, we have great speakers. They fly in. And somebody tells me, he says, here in France, Habacha said to me, we never see this type of thing. We never have mamadim gatherings with gedolim like this. We don't have it. The closest we ever had to something like this, sort of Aaron Leib Shteyman came to France. We never have it. So for us to walk into a room and see a gathering of, you know, countless gedolim, right, Rabbanim from France, from Eretz Yisrael, from America.
In the U.S. it happens a lot. In Israel, it obviously, it has a lot. And in Europe, it doesn't have that
well,
same thing.
Well, in England, maybe more.
Right, but not France, as much as the other two.
Right. So for them, it was an incredible thing. So where did it come out? So two things. Rav Shalom Kahn comes into the room, and he's like Rabbi Avadia, you know, right after. They are like in awe of Rav Shalom Kahn. He spoke very well. He speaks. He connects to people in their language. His humor, and he relates stories about Mishnah Berurah. Great. Another thing, when the music started after the Hadron, the place left their seats. They crowd the stage. It's like this concert. They crowd the VIP. We're sitting there writing, and I'm surrounded by these and they come over to me, and they grab my hand, and we're dancing, and the band is going crazy, and it's like the place is on fire. That's where their emotion came out. Right. You could see what they were really feeling. They were dancing. They were singing so loud, louder than the music. You could hear them.
How different do you think it would have been if not for what had happened, you know, just a few weeks ago? Like, what was it obvious that was part of the whole thing, that was part of the whole release that people were feeling as this was going on?
I think so. I mean, for them, again, they don't usually have this, so it probably would have been special anyways.
Correct. But with all that background.
For sure. I mean, here we're talking about people that are afraid. People, when I said I'm going to France, everybody's reaction was like, are you sure? Is it going to be safe? And I'm like, don't worry, I'm just going from the airport.
That's funny.
I'm telling you, everyone's reaction.
No, I'm saying it's funny because you live in Israel. Most people, right? You know, when we say we're going to Israel, oh, you sure?
And my kids are like, Tati, are you sure? Is it okay? I'm like, I'm just going. Can you put on a baseball cap?
All right.
But it was something special. There's a lot of there's a lot of emotions bubbling under the surface over there.
Rabbi Nachman Seltzer is here. We talk about Daf Yomi and we talk about the whole Deer Shoe program. Tonight will also be the same. I don't know. Should we say similar to what you saw in France, or it's different?
It's on a much bigger level, because when you have 10,000 people filling an arena, and when that music starts playing, and everybody's on their feet and they're screaming to HaKadosh Baruch Hu. Last time when we were covering this event, Avram Birnbaum and Shimmy Blum from Mishpacha and from Yatera, and we had Laban from Williamsburg, and we were up on our feet. The journalists, we left our computers, and we were like on our feet. We were dancing along with everybody. You couldn't stop the simcha when watching, the Belzer Rebbe was there, Aaron Leib Shteyman was there. The Gedolim of Eretz Yisrael are there, and the place was just one huge matzav of like simcha and Torah and Islavas. You had to be there to experience. You'll be there tonight. You'll see what I'm talking about. So France, it's much more intimate, much more personal. It was, it's coming on the tail end of what happened over there.
Yeah, to give people a perspective, there may have been, 1,000 people there or somewhere
France,
around that?
France, I would say about 1,200 people.
So obviously
which was a
very
great
different.
Crowd for France. Right. It was great. But here it's going to be 10,000 people. Right. And 10,000 people, the energy, compounded by,
Is it obvious?
More than 10,000 tonight, together with Binyanei Oma.
Yeah, right? That's for sure.
Yeah, it's going to be.
Is it obvious to you already what you're going to be writing about? Because you've just described the whole event to us, hasn't even taken place yet. I mean, is it sort of obvious at this point?
It's written already. Oh, I'm kidding.
But is it obvious to you what the theme will be as you.
I'll tell you, last time I covered this event, so it was the Siyum HaShas.
Right.
And I went to meet an Avrich, a younger man in Ramat Beit Shemesh Beis. I live in Ramat Beit Shemesh Aleph. Right. Yushalmiyid. And they're part of a kollel called Kollel Shas Yidden. And this guy is about 24 years old, 25 years old. He knew the whole Shas by heart. And I met him as part of my article. I had a sidebar covering meeting guys who know the whole Torah by heart. And that was something. That was crazy. So that was something that came up that wasn't part of what I was expected to write about.
Just so people get it, because I want to make sure everyone understands. You're talking about the entire Talmud by heart.
I'm talking about the entire Talmud
by
heart.
Every page of the
Talmud.
Every
page with tests, with Chazara. And then on the day of that was the Erev Shabbos before the event. Now, I come here to the event with the whole team. I walk out, I see this guy, and he introduces me to a bacher standing next to him who's 13. He says, see this boy? He finished Shas also. 13 years old, finish us also. That was a whole different sidebar. I wasn't, thinking that I was going to write about that, but that came up. So there's always surprises. There's always new directions. With Deir Shu, Rav David, it is always a new thought, as a chiddush. He's always bringing chiddushim to the table. It's never just, an event.
So there'll be a development, a statement, a comparison, a call to action. Something will happen tonight from the podium that you'll be able to grab onto.
I'm sure there'll be more than one thing.
Understood. Yitzchak Saflos, we have a recording of what happened in France as we speak to Rabbi Nachman Seltzer about this incredibly emotional and high-spirited and very inspirational night in Paris. You actually have a recording of it for us.
Yeah. Yeah, wait.
Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, we are going to play that soon, the Hadron itself. And then the orchestra, what was it, like a 10-piece orchestra?
The orchestra
very
was
lively.
Well, very lively.
Very lively orchestra.
It. Well, yeah, it's Ami Cohen. Ami Cohen is a big star on the wedding scene in Israel. Shlomo Cohen, Reb Shlomo Cohen, he's the guy from Lamala.
Right.
So, I mean, it was a winning. First of all, Rabbi Yitzchak always puts together a winning team. No, I'm serious. But he knows if you want to get a good product, you put the. Why are you here, Nachum? You're here because you're the best at what you do. He puts together the winning team. He always does it. So he brought it's the best orchestra, the best production people. And then you have the French Yidden, and they were the best. These are great Yidden. The fact that they're coming there at this time, that means these are great people.
Very precious. If I could jump in for a second.
Sure.
I'm going on a low amount of sleep, as you can imagine. But the fire that I'm getting from each scene, I'm going on 2-3 hours a night. But the energy is so driving. You could touch it. You could touch it.
Are you starting to pick it up now? Because I'm reminding everybody that we are just at before 2 o'clock. The event obviously starts 4 or 5 hours from now.
That's right.
Are you starting to feel it in this building yet?
Absolutely.
You're already getting that frenzy.
I'll try tweeting out some more pictures.
There you go. Are you feeling it, Rabbi Seltzer?
Through the floor. I feel the it's reverberating through the floor from the stage.
They're practicing, huh? Checking out all the sound systems. All right. Let's play some of the
absolutely.
Let's play some of the audio from France. This is actually the Hadron, the conclusion that took place in France for the Daf Yomi Bahalacha, and then right after that into this amazing orchestral performance that Rabbi Nachman Seltzer was alluding to moments ago. Here it is for you as we continue with a Tuesday morning edition from Yad Eliyahu at JM in the AM.
Nous allons demander maintenant à Rabbi Yitzhak Levi, à Gaon Rabbi Yitzhak Levi, de venir réciter le Kaddish qui suit le Hadran. Thank you.
JM in the AM. It is America's one and only Jewish Moments in the Morning radio program. Heard on listeners sponsored WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, Rockland County at 91.9 on the FM dial, around the world on the web, jmandtheam.org. I want to thank Itzhak Safos, gave us the actual recording of what happened at the Paris, France, Deer Shoe World Seum. That was the celebration that Rabbi Nachman Seltzer was talking about. I was still here with Yitzchak Saflis and Rabbi Nachman Seltzer. Does that bring back some memories, hearing the? Hearing that incredible.
It was something. Nachum, chaval, you weren't there. What a shame. You know, it was such a great.
Yeah, what happened to my trip to Paris?
I'm very surprised. You should have.
I thought I contacted my travel agent about heading to France. I don't know what happened. Rabbi Krohn was there.
Rabbi Krohn was there,
and he has a. You must appreciate this as a storyteller. His ability to connect with the audience.
You know, Rabbi Baruch Chait was once driving, and he said he heard on the radio they were playing Mia Isha Chavetz Chaim.
Right.
And then the announcer says, and that was Mia Isha Chavetz Chaim by Shlomo Kalbach. And Baruch Chait's like, wait a second, I made that song. And then he's like, you know what? That's a compliment.
Right.
They said that my song was a Kalbach song. So, you know, basically when I speak, you know, Baruch Hashem, I speak something around the world, and somebody comes up and says, I want you to know, your mom is like Rabbi Krohn. And I'm like, oh, that's a compliment. Thank you very much. You know?
Well, I didn't mean to say it like that. I'm just saying. You appreciate a good story, that's all.
I say it like that. I do say it like that.
So he got up, and what was the message that he told that evening?
So he said a lot. I mean, everything he said was really special. He did say a few things that really jumped out at me. He brought down this famous story with the Ramah and the Rav Yosef Cairo, and he said they were friends. And they used to communicate through letters. You know, back then, there was something called a letter. You'd send it, and it took time to get there.
The kids wouldn't know this, huh? Days
it's
sometimes.
It's a concept.
Days and weeks sometimes.
Weeks. And so does it didn't come. You know, it got lost in
now,
space.
If an email doesn't show up within 60 seconds, you're angry.
Anyway, so he says what happened. One day, the Ramah opens up a letter from Rav Yosef Cairo, and it says, this guy's telling him good news, he says. I'm just finishing my sefer, the Shulchan Aruch. And the Ramah almost faints. Why is he almost faint? Because he's also working on a Shulchan Aruch. He says, now you can imagine. The Ramah could have easily said, he's Sephardic, I'm Ashkenazi. The people in Yemen and the people in Syria and the people in Morocco will learn his Shulchan Aruch, right. And the people in Poland and Russia will learn mine. And I'll come out with my version. Can you imagine, you wrote the Shulchan Aruch.
Sure.
What are you going to do? He says, the Ramah says, I'm not doing that. I'm going to take my Pirush and I'm going to put it together with his Pirush and we're going to have one unified Shulchan Aruch so that there's not going to be a Pirush, there's not going to be a divide. There's going to be Achdus in Klal Yisrael, he said. And that's Dirshu. That's what Dirshu accomplishes. Rav David's vision is one of Achdus. He loves Klal Yisrael. When you hear him speak, you feel a palpable love for everybody he's talking to. You hear him, you see him. He loves the people. It's something special. You see it. You know when it's real.
100%.
I mean, for sure, you meet people. You meet people all the time. You feel when somebody's authentic.
And that's the whole purpose of these celebrations is to be together and be.
It bridges it. This is Sephardic Jews. Somebody said, I didn't know there were that many Ashkenazi Jews in France, he said to me.
Right.
No.
You think they're all Sephardic Jews.
It was such a beautiful mix. Such a beautiful mix. And that's the Dirshu message. I mean, it's the Torah accountability. It's learning. But it's also Achdus.
And with that in mind, I assume the Torah Giants tonight will represent every...
I'm sure. Always. And Rav David himself said something that jumped out at me really nice. He said that... He quoted the Chavetz Chaim. He said that... They asked the Chavetz Chaim, what do we do today? We don't have Nevi'im. We don't have prophets anymore. How are we supposed to know what Hashem wants from us? And the Chavetz Chaim said to us, today when there's no prophets, there's no Nevi'im. He said, the wind, the fire, the water, those are prophets of Hashem, he says. They tell us what Hashem wants. You know, you look around. If the fire gives you a message, if the water gives you, if the wind gives you a message, these are prophets of HaKadosh Baruch Hu. And that was such a poignant point that he was bringing up, especially in light of what's going on in the world.
Sure.
But it was... I mean, Rav David, again, if his speeches are a jewel, they're full of jewels. But just every speaker there was, I mean, somewhere in French, I didn't quite understand everything. But
did Rabbi Krohn, what was he? Was translated into
Hebrew,
France?
Hebrew, Ivrit, and somebody translated
into French.
But again, like I said, Dvar Mayot Simen Alev, you don't really need translation.
Where will we see what you write about tonight's event? Where will we see it?
Tonight's event will be everywhere. All over.
It's like you're a freelancer. Anywhere these words appear.
When I write for Dirshu and for Yitzchak Saflis, so basically the bottom line marketing company, they decide where everything, right, in conjunction with Avdov, they decide where every writer's words go. So it could be in Ami, it could be in Mishpacha, it could be in Hamodiyah. It's a real Achtas, you know. Normally I write for Hamodiyah, but when it comes to Dirshu, it crosses all the lines. There's no party over here. We're all together. You know?
And we could see you on a weekly basis in Hamodiyah?
In Hamodiyah, yeah, pretty much on a bi-weekly basis.
And that means that specifically news, or could be stories?
For the most part, it's true stories. Like, I'm waiting to hear from you maybe about Rav David Feinstein.
I don't know if I have any stories.
I am sure you have tons of stories. We have to do a piece about you. An interview with Rav Nachum Siegel.
Yeah, that's an idea.
That's it.
That's a big seller.
I'm going to sit over here and we're going to do an interview with you.
That's a big seller.
That's a huge seller. Normally it's true stories, but sometimes I did after the book, it could have, Inside Their Homes came out. So I did an interview with my friend Rabbi Yamin, a follow-up. Or else I just interviewed the head of PR for Hadassah Hospital, Barbara Sofer. I interviewed her. And that's going to be in the Pesach magazine in Hamodiyah. It's a fascinating interview about Hadassah Hospital in Yerushalayim.
So there's always,
you meet people, and everyone you meet is just so interesting, and it's, you know, full of just great stuff. So, you know, it's wherever you go, it just, things are happening.
It's a pleasure spending time with you. Thank you for stopping by.
Likewise, mutual.
And enjoy tonight.
I'm looking forward.
Rabbi Nachman Seltzer, I thank you, Rabbi Yitzchak Saflis, for setting this up. We are here at the Dirshu World Siyum in Tel Aviv. There'll be one in Yerushalayim tonight as well. This is one of the selections that Dirshu released on their most recent collection of World Siyum tunes. Here it is at JM in the AM.
Sharei Tzion, mikol mishkenot Yaakov. Ohev Hashem shehorim, ametzuyonim, ametzuyonim b'halochot. Ohev Hashem Sharei Tzion, Sharei Tzion. Mikol mishkenois yakoy Oyei vashem sheori hametzuyonim hametzuyonim balocho
Hey, man. Sunim batzor uvashigi giveyo acheinu kol beis isrove acheinu kol beis isrove acheinu kol beis isrove hopin di main bayo Vein bayavosho, acheinu kol beis Yisrove. Lo yamotoi yirachem aleihem v'yotzigei mitzoron yirvocho.
JM in the AM. We're at the Deer Shoe World Seum. It's happening here at Yad Eliyahu in Tel Aviv. This is part of the Deer Shoe World Tour, as I call it, since they've been to so many locations around the world already, including the U.S. and Great Britain and France, South Africa. They're going to be heading to South America as well. But tonight the focus is on Yerushalayim and Tel Aviv, the Deer Shoe World Seum. It's happening tonight, just a couple hours from now. You'll hear it during Wednesday's JM and the AM. We're actually going to be pre-recording Wednesday's JM and the AM from here, from Israel. I want to take this opportunity to thank our friends at Travel Cell, Josh Melman and company. It's because of them that we're connected back to the U.S. Big thank you to our friends at Travel Cell. A lot of people in our audience are going to be using them when they head to Israel for Sukkot, so enjoy. For Pesach, rather, so enjoy. I want to thank the Inbal Hotel for, again, being our home base in the city of Jerusalem. And Alex Herman and his staff doing a great job over there, and I thank him very much. A big thank you to Stan in our studio, ZK, of course, PC guy who's here, helping us out as always. Want to thank Danny Goldberg doing our social media back in the U.S. Yitzchak Saflos is with me here from Bottom Line Marketing Group, and of course Pesach Trapper and Chaim Weiser as well get big thank yous for all their work in advance of this event. Yitzchak's holding a book. You could see it if you go to the NahumSiegel.com video screen, which is on the homepage of our website. Holding a brand new book, Odyssey of a Revolution, a Deer Shoe Legacy Sefer. This is a 312 full-color hardcover book released in conjunction with this World Seum tour. Tell me about the significance of this amazing publication.
Well, the organization, as Rabbi Friend pointed out in his speech, is making a revolution in accountability and learning Torah. Rav David has a vision of rebuilding, rebuilding the level of Limud HaTorah the way it was even pre-war.
Right.
That is something that he has stated. The organization has had tremendous milestones over the past 18 years. It was founded in 1997, Tavshin Nun Ches, and the goal was to really capture in a coffee table format book the accomplishments of so many in Klal Yisrael who were inspired through Deir Shu. So there are some sections that cover Deir Shu through the years,
including the big Seum from a couple of years
ago. Of
course,
ago, right? Okay, that's covered. And then
plus the Shiurim, I know they're in there.
Plus all the Shiurim and the impacts around the world, the accomplishments, the Mishneh Berurah, the Deir Shu Mishneh Berurah, which is found in homes across the world.
I noticed they set up a big display here to sell it tonight.
That's correct. because also so many people have joined now for the second Machzor, right. Dafi and Balocha, so they need a Mishneh Berurah. Also, there's something I wanted to explain about Dafi Yemi Balocha. Sometimes people wonder, is it, because we know a daf is a front and a back.
Correct.
Okay, and that's a question that has come up. What happens is, on the Deir Shu Mishneh Berurah, so one side is the side that basically has everything that the Chofetz Chaim put down. In the last 100 years, and even though the Chofetz Chaim had Ruach HaKodesh, but he didn't write it to know with all the Shilas and all the questions that will come up for today's times.
Right, decisions that have to be made for
correct.
The 2000s.
That's correct. So therefore, Deir Shu put together this Mishneh Berurah, which has all the decisions, the psakim, if you will, of many Rabbanim over the last 10, 20, 30 years, and it has their psak on modern-day shilas that have to do with travel and electricity, right. Things that just weren't.
And there's hardly a page that goes by without that, right? It's there's a lot of it in there.
Every single...
Every page has it?
Every Amid has material,
right.
Believe it or not.
Right.
Everything. That's how... So therefore, the Dafei Yubalocha, it's one Amud of the existing Mishneh Berurah,
right.
And the other Amud is of the Deir Shu Mishneh Berurah.
Where's the Odyssey of a Revolution, as we go back to the Deir Shu Legacy Sefer, where's it available?
That's it's being distributed by Israel Bookshop, so it will be in Sfarim stores worldwide.
So people out there, if they want something special for Pesach,
that's correct.
To read over Yontif.
This is, and it's filled with the accomplishments of so many in Klal Yisrael, It, of course, has amazing Gedolim pictures. I will say something that's very precious are we included some personal notes that people wrote to Rav David or the organization.
Meaning students of Dershow.
Yeah, there's a letter here that's just, every time I read it, I cry. It brings out how special these families are. And the Mesiras Nefesh of the wife, of the children, for their husbands to learn with this level. Keep in mind, when someone's taking a Bechina on 30 blot, or someone's taking a Bechina on 90 blot,
they need to prepare.
Or someone's taking on 120 blot, there's a lot of preparation. I don't know if I should joke like this on the air, but I wish I could take the Bechina and get a 20. So certain, there are people out there that get 100. You know what that is? These people are going to be the Gedolei Yisrael in 10 years from now, 20 years from now, 30 years from now. Rav David's vision is a Reis HaNoilad.
Way ahead of his time.
And that's what's going on. And then the Sefer so includes many beautiful Gedolim pictures, trips to run. And then a book like this would not be complete without listing the test takers. Do you know there are over 5,000 test takers in North America? North America.
And they're all listed in the book.
Yeah, listed in the book because they get Plus you
have a map that describes where the shurim take place on a regular basis, which is pretty cool.
We have a map of also where Dershow has a presence and has touched people throughout the world.
And obviously Israel and the United States dominates that. Yeah. It's pretty amazing. Check it out. Odyssey of a Revolution is out there, and it will be available as you get closer and closer to Pesach. And it is an amazing tribute to what's happening here at Dershow. More coming up. This is JM in the AM for a Tuesday morning broadcast tomorrow from the actual Siyum, which we'll pre-record here later on tonight. They're getting ready behind us in the arena itself at 2:20 in the afternoon here on a Tuesday for the big Siyum tonight, the Dershow World Siyum celebration taking place for Daf Yomi Bahalacha, and it'll be one big celebration coming up tonight in this arena. Meanwhile, we continue with more from the Dershow World Siyum CD at JM in the AM. Tuesday morning, live from the Dirshu World Seum in Tel Aviv. I was about to say Yerushalayim is one in Yerushalayim tonight as well. I want to thank the PC Guy, your one-stop shop for all your technology needs in Jerusalem and many of your technologies worldwide. In just 5 years in Jerusalem, the PC Guy has become the leading support for all PC and internet needs. Congratulations, PC Guy. If you need a new PC or your existing one that needs a tune-up, call them. If you need a brand new printer, scanner, fax, copier, or have trouble with your existing one, call them. If you're new to your smartphone or iPad, call them to integrate your contacts and email. I could use that. Here, get to work on this iPad immediately. If you don't back up your PC, call the PC Guy for his advanced cloud-based backup service available worldwide. If you want internet, Israeli phone, and U.S. phone service from one source with one number to call for support in English, call the PC Guy. If you own an apartment in Yerushalayim, I want to have support for your internet when you're not there, call the PC Guy. Just give him the keys to the apartment. He'll take care of the rest. Trust me. And if he's renting your place out, unbeknownst to you, don't blame me. Paul, the PC Guy Sirkin, is at 054-943-6109. Great friend of the show and somebody who's always helping us like today. ThePCGuy.co.il. Yitzchak Saflis is here. One of the things that started this whole process of getting to the World Seum in Tel Aviv was the trip that was taken by many to Radin. They actually went to the final resting place of the Chofetz Chaim. I don't know if you were on the trip or not, so you could tell me.
No,
you were not, but you spoke to plenty who were, right?
Absolutely.
And in fact, down the road, it would be a good idea for me to speak to Eitan Kobri. He actually wrote the article about it, right?
That's right.
And it was a long article.
Wrote
a lot
piece.
Of stuff in it. And what was the reaction? I mean, it must have gotten this whole venture off to a very good start.
Yes. Naturally, the Dirshu's goal here is to enroll, encourage that everyone should have a daily limit of halacha
right.
in this particular program, Daf Yomi B'Halacha. So in conjunction with this, Rav David felt that it would be, an auspicious time to go to the caver of the Halakha Chafetz Chaim.
The author of the Mishnah Berurah.
The author of the Mishnah Berurah, and be mispalled by the caver. So the Dirshu organization came up with this fantastic idea that we're going to travel, and many leading Gedolei Yisrael, Rav Chizkiya Mishkovsky, among others, Rav Binyamin Finkel, they got together, they met, some came from America, right. Many came from Eretz Yisrael, and they traveled. The whole thing was a 24 to 36 hour maisa. And they traveled to the Kever of the Chafetz Chaim, and they brought something called the Sefer HaGiborim. If you remember, there was a campaign going. Okay.
We had listeners who became part of it.
And became part, correct. Now, the Sefer Gibarim was a fantastic concept, and that was that anyone who would commit, and we know that there are many organizations that have, that if you donate, if you give support, then they'll be misspelled by a kever. Here, the goal was just commit that you're going to learn halach every day. And you could say Bli Neder. If you need to back out, then we'll set
just the that commitment got you into the Sefer.
Just the commitment you got into the Sefer, and you could put down for any bracha, yeshua, or for anything. You know, in America, you know, people always say, okay, like a cute idea, you know, what's going to happen already? First, they were, you know, the first week, maybe 30 came in, and 40. In the end, there were over 1,000 people that wrote in. Now, keep in mind, a lot of times, of course, in hindsight, people said, yeah, of course, everyone would do it. But wait a second, it's easier to write out an $18 check and have someone
like
drive to a kever than to learn a half hour a day halacha.
Right.
And there were over 1,000 people that took on that commitment.
Which is pretty amazing.
That's pretty amazing.
The brand new Daf Yomi Ba'alacha calendar is out. I assume people can guess this from Dirshu, right?
The Luach booklet.
We're actually on day three of the cycle, by
yes,
the way.
Yes, we are on day three. Not too late to join.
That's correct.
Okay.
Although I still like to say I'm already behind, but yes, not too late
okay,
to join.
If you want to officially be behind, you are behind, Nachum.
There you go.
We accommodated. By the way, talking about allowing room for people at Slack, this program has an amazing feature to it. It's called Daf Yomi Ba'Halacha, but it's really 5 days a week.
Right, correct.
Sunday, Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday.
There's leeway built in.
Friday and Shabbos is for Chazara.
Correct.
To
review what you've done.
In fact, the shiur that I attend every day by Rabbi Cheskel Eichenstein for Daf Yomi Ba'Halacha, so he doesn't do Sunday, but he does it Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday. And Sunday and Shabbos is for Chazar. These booklets are being distributed throughout America at this time this weekend, so they will be available all over.
All right. In it, there's a listing of Daf Yomi Ba'Halacha Shirim that take place, and if you'd like a luach or if you just want to sign up for the daily e-newsletter or get information about all of this, you can write to the following email address, info@koleldirshu.org. Info@koleldirshu.org. There are three L's in Kolel. It's the middle L that gets doubled. info@koleldirshu.org, and you can get all the information regarding that and find out about the shiurim, et cetera. You can also call, good point, 8885-DIRSHU, 8885-DIRSHU. They take care of that as well. And you can sign up for the audio, for the e-newsletter, et cetera, et cetera.
And their shiurim throughout America.
Right.
Now,
many,
it's interesting,
different cities.
When we put this calendar together roughly, I don't know, 3 weeks ago, by now, there's double the amount of shiurim.
Really?
Meaning, it's a fascinating thing. When there's a campaign that goes on and there's this much piersum, there's this much coverage that comes out, there's a result. So there was so many shiurim that sprouted up within the last 7 to 10 days. The schedule is correct, of course,
right.
But the listing of shiurim
is
half of what it is now. So Mit Hashem, there will be advertising and ways of getting that information, but there are shiurim popping up around North America and the world.
Pretty amazing. I believe this selection was written by Rav David Hofstadter, if I'm not mistaken, the third selection on the...
Yeah, Tana Devei Elio.
This is his composition.
Yep. Yeah.
We'll do this in tribute to all those who've taken on the commitment to do Daf Yomi Ba'Halacha, the big celebration tonight in Tel Aviv, and we're here all the way in Israel celebrating this occasion. You're listening to JM in the AM.
tunu dvai ayli yuhi tunu dvai ayli shoyne halu khol yo khol yo kala shoyne halu khol yo khol yo khol yo miftach loy shehi ונוי לא מבוא מבטח לו שהיא ונוי לא מבוא מבטח לו שהיא ונוי לא מבוא ונוי לא מבוא מבטח לו שהיא ונוי לא מבוא מבטח לו שהיא בנוי לא מבוא מבטח לו שהיא בנוי לא מבוא בנוי לא shoyne halu khoy bekhol yoy bekhol yoy kala shoyne halu khoy bekhol yoy bekhol babal yoy mitakh loy shehi benoy lo mabu miftach loy shehi benoy lo mabu miftach loy shehi benoy lo mabu benoy lo mabu miftach loy shehi benoy lo mabu Mitach loy shehi benoy lo mabu Mitach loy shehi benoy lo mabu benoy lo mabu shehi benoy lo mabu mitach loy shehi benoy lo mabu benoy lo mabu thank you.
Hashem Sharei Tzion, Sharei Tzion, Mikol Mishkenoi Yaakov. Oyev Hashem Sheori, Ametzuyonim, Ametzuyonim Balochot.
Oyev Hashem Sharei Tzion, Sharei Tzion, Mikol Mishkenoi Yaakov. Oyev Hashem Sheori, Ametzuyonim, Ametzuyonim Malochot. Heine Eloi Lakodosh Baruch Hu, Heine Eloi Beyoi Lomoi, Hayelo Abba Amoi, Shel Alocho, Shel Alocho Bilvod. Heine Eloi Lakodosh Baruch Hu, Heine Eloi Beyoi Lomoi, Hayelo Abba Amois, Shel Alocho, Shel Alocho Bilvo. Hashem Sheorim, Ametzuyonim, Ametzuyonim Bahalochot. Uyev Hashem Sharei Tzion, Sharei Tzion, Mikol Mishkenois Yaakov. Uyev Hashem Sheorim, Ametzuyonim, Ametzuyonim Malochot. Heine Eloi Lakodosh Baruch Hu, Heine Eloi Beyoi Lomoi, Hayelo Arba Amois, Shel Alochot, Shel Alochot
all the action at NahumSiegel.com. We are here at the Yad Eliyahu Arena in Tel Aviv. Some of the selections prepared specifically for this Dirshu World Siyum, the one that speaks of Daf Yomi Bahalacha. I wanted to make sure to mention that Dirshu has a has a regular Daf Yomi program. And this is something that Yitzhak Saflis reminded me about months ago. We've been spending so much time on Daf Yomi B'Halacha, we forgot they have their own system with testing, with the ability to be held accountable to Daf Yomi, and that obviously over the years has grown tremendously.
You know, I sometimes encourage friends, said, visit a testing site. Every 30 days, there are testing sites all across North America and throughout the world. So just walk into one and see what goes on. It's really special. You go in there, the Bar Park one happens to be a quite large one. And there are hundreds of people that come in and start taking a test. And you realize that the hours, days, weeks of preparation, and these people are going to be Shas Yidden. They're going to be Shas Yidden. They're going to really be kind of Shas.
And really know it.
They have to be accountable. And
Daf Yomi B'Halacha works the same way with tests on the different parts of Mishnah Berurah that are studied on a daily basis.
Correct, but I'm sorry to interrupt. A very important point. The organization doesn't want people to feel restricted or inhibited if they're not going to take the test. That's
cause good point.
I bring that
right.
Because it comes right. Up all the time.
Right. What if I don't want to take the test?
Especially right. With Daf Yomi B'Halacha.
Right.
There's a daily limud. Many people are maybe not up to it.
Right.
We'll say it like that. Okay.
They don't want to make that commitment.
So therefore, there's no pressure to take a bechina. And the question comes in a lot to those. It's like, I'm willing to join, but I'm afraid of taking the bechina.
Yeah, of course.
You do not have to take the bechina. If you're able to take the bechina, great. And they give stipends based on good, successful scores. But a person does not have to take the bechina.
Information about all of this, 888-5-DEAR-SHU, 888-5-DEAR-SHU, the free luach that you can keep track of each day, the daily e-newsletter you can sign up for at info@koleldeershu.org. Again, it's 888-5-DEAR-SHU. You can also find out where Shiurim are in your neighborhood. And there's an audio share, as we pointed out. And we'll probably speak tomorrow to Rabbi Gobioff about that as well. An audio
That's
share
correct.
Is available
That's
every
correct.
Single day as well. You've handed me a track. Tell everybody what this is.
Yeah, there was a CD that came out. It's a shame it's not available in America. It's such a great CD that it has the selections of the live music from Yad Eliyahu
right.
2012 of the CMS Shas.
Right.
It's an amazing clip. The orchestra, the singers, the whole experience. I wish it was available in the U.S.
Here's how we'll wrap up our show from Yad Eliyahu as we celebrate the Dirshu World Siyum, which is just hours away. This is JM in the AM.
We'll be right back.
some of the celebration the last time Dirshu had a World Series in Yad Eliyahu. That's from 3 years ago. Tonight, the big event here, the Dirshu World Series for Daf Yomi Ba'alacha. My thanks to Yitzchak Saflos and all of our special guests. Big yasher koach to you, Yitzchak.
Thank you. And, of course, looking forward to tomorrow's presentation.
Yeah, tomorrow's going to be our visit to Yad Eliyahu tonight for the actual event. Correct. When there'll be about 10,000 more people in this building. 12,000?
It's really going to be around 13,000 because they're filling up the floor and all extra crevices. And, of course, Binyanei Huma's hookup and hookups around the world as well. So
it'll be in the tens of thousands tonight.
When you add it all up.
For the big celebration. So big yasher koach. Information about Dirshu, 8885 Dirshu. A pleasure to speak to everybody from the Holy Land. I wanted to note the passing of Yehuda Avner. Ambassador Avner passed away, and the funeral takes place at 4:30 Israel time this afternoon. Somebody who had a major impact on modern Jewish history, especially vis-a-vis the State of Israel, and somebody who is a beloved figure by world Jewry of all types. And we note his passing, and that funeral takes place later today. I want to remind everybody in terms of our schedule that we will be on tomorrow morning, JM and the AM, from here tonight. Not live, of course, but doing the show tonight, and then airing it tomorrow morning between 6 and 9 from the Dirshu World. See you, Mayor Fertigan studio on Thursday, and then Friday we are back with the weekly update and everything you'd expect on a Friday morning broadcast from us here at JM and AM. So keep that in mind. Also, you'll be able to see you'll be able to hear the archive of this show, obviously, later on. The video archive will be up eventually at NahumSiegel.com. And we will be videoing tonight here in the arena, which means that while the show is going on, you'll be able to access it tomorrow morning at NahumSiegel.com and see all the action as the arena fills up behind us and all the celebrating takes place in Yad Eliyahu in Tel Aviv. A big thank you to our friends at TravelCell for keeping us connected to the United States and for really helping us in terms of keeping our radio connected as well. And a big thank you to the Inbal Hotel for serving as our home base in Jerusalem. And a big thank you to Miriam L. Wallach and ZK and PC Guy and everybody who worked so hard, Yitzchak Saflos and his staff, including Pesach and Rabbi Weiser and everybody who was helpful here in Israel. Achenu b'Yisrael, Achim Achem, our brothers and sisters in Israel, we are with you. It's your favorite, America's one and only Jewish Moments in the Morning radio program, heard on listeners sponsored WFMU East Orange, WMFU Mount Hope, Rockland County at 91.9 on the FM dial, around the world on the web, jmandtheam.org. A big mazel tov to Rabbi David Hofstadter and everybody at Dirshu as the World Siyum takes place tonight. More details, obviously, tomorrow morning right here at JM and the AM. Stay with our stream all day long at jmandtheam.org. Until tomorrow, from Israel, Nachum Siegel reminding you, remember the past, live the present, and trust the future.